Hi, welcome to my video. I'm just going through the offence of battery. So last week you looked at the offence of assault. Assault and battery make up an offence called common assault. So where you tend to read in the news or hear about on TV where a person has been assaulted, the media tends to refer to the broad term of common assault. But common assault is actually an umbrella offence which contains two. A technical assault, which we looked at last week, where the defendant does an act which makes the victim apprehend immediate unlawful force. And then we actually have the application of unlawful force, which is battery. Now, the offences themselves are common law and they are defined by common law. So they're defined by judges through precedent. But the sentence and the offence is listed in Section 39 of the Criminal Justice Act 1988. They are both summary offences, and that means that you would get up to a maximum of 6 months imprisonment or a fine. So the two tend to happen together. So you'll have someone threatening, "I am going to punch you," and then they punch. So you tend to get assault and battery very quickly together. But you can, of course, get battery without an assault, and that would be where the person doesn't expect force before it actually occurs to them. So an example would be if a person was approached from behind or in the dark, for example, the victim wouldn't fear force before it was actually applied to them. But they do tend to go together, and because of that, students can sometimes get them mixed up. So what I want to do is just go through the actus reus and mens rea. So define the offence, explain the offence with case examples. So the definition of battery is the unlawful application of force to another person, and you have to intend or be reckless as to that occurring. So obviously the actus reus is the application of unlawful force to another person, and then the mens rea is either you intended to apply this unlawful force to another, or you were reckless as to whether you would apply unlawful force to another. So in terms of what these mean, there's quite a lot of detail in your handouts, and you'll be having a look at the cases, but it's just worth actually being aware of what there is out there. So first off, when it comes to application of force, so how can you actually apply it to another person? Well, it can be even the slightest touch. So just touching someone's arm, for example, could potentially be a battery if it's application of unlawful, unwanted force. So in the case of Collins versus Wilcock, for example, the policewoman kind of took hold of the woman's arm to stop her walking away from questioning. Now, that in itself would be a battery, and that's what we would call a direct application, but it can be done in other ways. So it can be seen through a continuing act. We've seen this in the case of Fagan versus Metropolitan Police Commissioner way back at the start of the year. And in Fagan, the defendant accidentally parked on the police officer's foot, had actus reus because he'd applied unlawful force to the police officer but didn't actually realise, so no mens rea. And if you remember, when asked to move, the defendant refused. He stayed parked on the officer's foot, thought it was hilarious. So eventually he moved off and he denied he was guilty of assaulting a police officer. Remember that term. He denied that and he said, "Well, I didn't mean to." And the court said it can be a continuing act. So if someone grabs your arm, we have that initial application of force and then it's a continuing act as you won't let go. So we saw that in the case of Fagan. It can, of course, be as direct as that, but it could be done indirectly as well. And that's kind of through other objects or traps, for example. In the case of DPP versus K, it wasn't a trap. It was something that the boy did. They stole acid from the science lab and hid it in the hand dryer. He intended to return it, but it came out of the hand dryer and burnt another kid's hands. So he was charged with battery because it's the indirect application of force. So he applied unlawful force to another. He applied the acid to another kid, but it was through indirect means. So setting of booby traps would be kind of this. You can also do it through a kind of indirect chain, as you see in Haystead. So the defendant punched the victim who was holding a baby. That caused her to drop the baby. That was applying unlawful force to the baby as well because it was applied through her. Finally, it doesn't just have to be an act like grabbing or poking or punching. It could be by omission. And if you remember from our first couple of weeks, an omission is a failure to act when you should have. Now, DPP versus Santa Bermudez is a good example of failing to act when they should have, when they have a statutory duty and where they created the danger. So the defendant's pockets were being searched by a police officer. The police officer asked if they had any dangerous objects on their person. They should have replied yes, but they replied no. So when the police officer put a hand in the defendant's pocket, it was pricked by a needle. So there was a syringe in the defendant's pocket. The court said that this was applying force by omission, because he'd applied force to her, he'd applied the needle to her by failing to tell her it was in there. So by having a syringe, he created a dangerous situation, and therefore he should have told her that it was there to stop the force applying to her. So unlawful force, what do we mean by unlawful? Of course, we've touched on this a little bit when we've talked about murder, but essentially unlawful force is force that is not acceptable. There's a number of reasons why a person might be lawfully allowed to touch another, and I've just talked about a few examples here, and we'll talk about more as well when we do defences. So one of the big ones is consent. So of course we allow people to touch us either through express or implied consent. So you might say to someone, please, you know, cut my hair, or if you've got the hairdressers and they wash your hair, that's applying force, but it's not going to be unlawful because it's allowed. You've got the dentist, it's the same kind of thing. The doctor examines you, it's application of force, but it's lawful because it comes with your consent. It could be out of necessity, for example, if a person is unconscious and needs medical attention. You know, they can't give consent because they're unconscious, but it could be necessary to save that person's life. It could be by other lawful authority as well. So, for example, the police are allowed to lawfully touch you under arrest. It wasn't an arrest in Collins versus Wilcock. They were simply asking her questions, so they had no right to stop her. It could be in self-defense, and that's something that we talked about, murder. So if someone's coming at you with a knife, you could push them away. That would be application of force to another, but it wouldn't be unlawful in those circumstances. Another example is chastisement of children, so smacking naughty kids. The law does allow it as long as it doesn't harm the child. So for example, if it leaves a mark, that would be classed as some harm. So that wouldn't be allowed, but smacking is in theory lawful force. So you might want to think about some of the sort of good and bad sides of why we would allow it. I mean, consent covers such a wide range, and we'll talk more about this when we study offences, but you need to have lawful contact to play things like rugby or do martial arts. We need it for rescuing people. You might touch each other as part of practical jokes and things like that. We have the ordinary hustle and bustle of everyday life, or we used to. So, you know, it used to be that, you know, if you were getting onto a busy metro, you might bump into people, you might touch them. That was an application of unlawful force because some social contact was kind of expected as part of everyday life. It'd be really interesting, I know, if we still have that rule now, of course, with social distancing, whether bumping into people is still sort of expected everyday touching. Finally, this idea of force is normally what trips up students. So the idea force can be the slightest touch, even a touch. So if you imagine, for example, you're at a Christmas party and someone says, can I kiss you? And you say no, and they kiss you anyway, that would be application of unlawful force to another because it's been applied. It's unlawful because it's not consented to, and a kiss is force. So the slightest touch, we saw this in Collins versus Wilcox. She grabbed her arm, it didn't really hurt, but it was still just counted as the slightest touch. We sort of see this in Fraser if we're arresting people wrongly. In the case of R versus Thomas, we saw that the defendant grabbed a girl's skirt. They didn't actually touch. They didn't actually touch the victim's skin. And the question was, is that applying unlawful force to another if it's actually to their clothes? And the court said yes. So, you know, if I grab a person's bag, a backpack while they're wearing it, that would still be applying force. If I grabbed someone's sleeve or dress, or as long as they're wearing it, of course, that is still counted as their person. And you know, force is kind of where we are touching a person and it doesn't result in harm. So in your handouts on page 17, I've put down some examples of the Crown Prosecution Service's charging standards. Now, this isn't a kind of be-all and end-all list, but this gives you an indication of what real-life prosecutors would class as battery. So anything from the slightest touch, but no more from kind of like a graze or a scratch, minor abrasions, minor bruising, a black eye, which is just a sort of bruising around the eye, is likely just to be battery, some swelling. If your skin just goes red, so, you know, sometimes if you pinch, it can go red. Superficial cuts, so I'm thinking kind of paper cuts which don't break any of the skin, so, you know, where you've just got a bit of a sort of a scratch, a bit of a mark, and a very minor, what we call undisplaced broken nose. So it's not, the bone's not broken, it's just slightly fractured, it's quite a minor thing. I mean, those are what the CPS would practically in real life charge as batteries. I would say the moment you feel like they've been hurt, that's where you need to have a look at an offence beyond battery. So the actus reus is the application of unlawful force to another person, not harming them, just applying force or push, a touch, all of those things would be a potential battery without lawful reason to. In terms of the mens rea, you can have one or the other, because it's what we call a basic intent offence. So we'll accept either. So either the person intended to do this. So for example, in Collins versus Wilcox, she intended to stop her walking away when she grabbed her arm. Or you were reckless as to whether you might apply force to another. So remember, we looked at recklessness in week one. So a bit of alliteration. Recklessness is where you realise the risk and you do it anyway. So for example, in DPP versus K, the boy was reckless when he put the acid in the hand dryer. So he wasn't intending to hurt anyone else, he was just intending to hide it. But when he hid it, he realised the risk that it could kind of escape, and he left it where he did anyway. So he didn't mean to hurt anybody, but he realised the risk that he could hurt somebody. So as long as you have either one of those while you're doing this, you could be looking at up to 6 months. So thank you for watching. I hope that makes sense. So what you need to do now is to have a look through the handout. You've got some questions to answer and some scenarios to practice this with, and being really clear in the difference between just the expectation of force coming, no touching, and then battery. A touch up to harm, but not including harm. That'll be ABH, which is the subject of our next lesson. Thanks for watching.